Hello, my dear students. I am Anuradha from Arden Progressive School. Welcome you all in grade 11th. Okay, so in our video lecture, today we will start the first chapter of biology. Okay, so we must be knowing that what is biology. Today what we are going to start about the biology. Subject is what? Biology. So what do you understand by this term? Okay, so before going through the topic, we will understand that what we understood about this biology. It consists of two terms. What are they? Bio plus logy. Bio, something which we are talking about the living one, and logy means to study. Okay, so it comprises of two terms. What are they? That bio means living one and logy means to study. So in this subject we are going to study about the living organisms. Whatever the living organism present on this earth, we will study about it. Okay, whether these are the lower organisms or the higher organism, whether it is a plant cell, plant, or it can be animal, right? So we are going to discuss about this one. Now, very important thing, biology divided into two areas. Okay, if we are going to study about the plants, there is one another study, and if we are talking about the animals, there will be another study. Okay, so on that basis, biology having two areas. What are they? Zoology, and we are pronouncing it as a zoology also, and another one is the botany. Okay, again, zoo means what? Zoo, you can relate the word from the animals. Animals there, if you will visit the zoo, what you can see there? Animals. Okay, so that's why zoo relates to what? Something related to the animals. Logy means to study. So whenever we are emphasizing the word zoology, it means that we are studying only and only about the animals. So in zoology, what we are doing? We are studying about the animals. In botany, what we are considering? We are considering the plants. Okay, so we are having two areas of biology. There are so many areas like microbiology, biotechnology, but we are not considering all these one. Basically, we are going to study about the plant or the animals, right? That's why we should know that what is zoology and what is botany, right? Now, another important thing about this one, that father of biology, okay, very important question. The father of biology is what? Aristotle, right? If I will ask you the father of this zoology, again it is the Aristotle. But if I will talk about the botany, it is what? The father of botany, or about the plants, is the Theophrastus. Okay, so Theophrastus is what? Father of botany, and Aristotle, father of zoology, right? So likewise, these are some basic thing we should know about the subject which we are going to study in detail, right? Now, as the chapter name is what? The living world. What do you understand by world? It means that whole universe we are talking about, okay? And in this world, we all are living, right? As well as living world, something is alive, right? So it means that we are going to study that what do you understand by the living world, okay? How can you say that this one is living and another one is non-living? For example, I am living one, okay, and this marker is non-living. So why we are calling it non-living? Why it is different from me? So we should know the characteristic of life. How can you say that this is the life and this is not the life, right? So here in this chapter, basically we will discuss about the living organism or the characteristics of the living organism, right? So I'm just rubbing it here. So if we will proceed further, what we will observe, that what is life, okay, and how can you say that life is there? So if you will see the NCERT, you will see one name there, Ernest Mayr, very important name. Why? Some basic thing about Ernest Mayr, that is, he was the German biologist, okay, biologist, and he was also known as the Darwin of 20th century. Okay, it means that he did some more work, he has given more contribution towards the biology. Okay, so an important question again, the biological concept of species given by whom? By the Ernest Mayr. Okay, so you must know about the Ernest Mayr here. Now, we will move towards the main topic, that is the life. what do you understand by living being and non-living being? Okay, or the living organism or non-living. It means that if something is growing, if something is responding, right, we are calling them living one. But this marker, it is non-living. Why it is non-living? Because it is not responding. Okay, it is not going to develop its another marker. Okay, so it is one only, and it is not having ability to move from one place to another place. By this you can say that it is non-living and it is also not respiring, right? And if I will talk about the living organism like me, what are the characteristics? I can grow, okay, I can move from one place to another place, or I can reproduce, right? So like this we are considering the characteristic of life. Now the question arises that whatever the characteristics I have told you right now, are they the characteristics? Are they the real characteristics of life? Right? So we will understand that whatever the things I have said right now, they are correct or they are incorrect. So how you will come to know? When you will study each and every characteristic of the living organisms. Okay? So first of all, if I will see here that how can you say life is there if some growth is there, okay? If I will talk about me, I'm growing, okay? I have grown up. So what is there? Life is there, okay? This marker cannot grow, right? So it is not, we are not considering it a life, okay? Then reproduction. Reproduction is what? To producing its copy, okay? It means that again and again there is production of the offspring. So it is happening in case of the living organism, it cannot be seen in non-living organism, right? Then comes to the metabolism. Metabolism is something related to the activities which is happening inside the body. So in this marker, no metabolic activity can take place, right? Likewise, we are having cellular organization. How the cell is made up of? If I will talk about this marker, no cell is there, okay? And consciousness, how the body is going to respond. Okay, this marker cannot respond to any stimuli. If you will break it, what will happen? There will be no response, right? So it means that no consciousness in this marker. Likewise, we can say these are the characteristics of life. But again, we are talking about the exclusive property. It means that, what do you understand by the exclusive property? It means that whether it is a defining property of life, yes or no. Okay, so here we will prove it from here. The first characteristics which we are going to study it here, that is a growth. Okay, we are saying that yes, if life is there, then it means that there will be growth. So whether the statement is correct, yes or no. So we can say it is having twin characteristics. What do you understand by twin? It means that it is having two characteristics. Okay, what are the two characteristics? We can say if whenever we are talking about the growth is what? Increase in mass. Okay, what do you understand by growth? Increase in mass. And another one, increase in number of cells, increase in number of cells or the individuals, right? So by this it is having twin characteristics. Why? Because we can say if something is growing, okay, if some mass is growing, then there will be a growth if the number of cells will get increasing or the number of individuals will get increasing, like reproduction. Okay, so we can say that this is the characteristic of life. Okay, and we are considering both as a growth. For example, if I will talk about the human beings, what is happening? There will be a proper cell division. Okay, due to this cell division, what is happening? We are growing, our body cells getting increase. Okay, due to the repair, and due to this, what is happening? There will be continuous repairment of the cell. Okay, and again, due to this division, what is happening? The number of cells, they are also increasing, right? So we are considering these two things in the growth. Okay, as well as this growth should be irreversible or the permanent. Irreversible means once it has been achieved, it should not go back. Okay, for example, in case of human beings, once we are growing that much, we cannot move or we cannot reverse the process of growth. Okay, this is what irreversible, as well as it should be permanent. Okay, if it is irreversible, it means that it is permanent. Now it is not going to change here. Okay, so this is the characteristics of growth. And on the basis of the characteristics or on the basis of the behavior, we have categorized the growth can be indeterminate growth or the determinate growth, right? So we have considered it here as an indeterminate growth as well as the determinate growth. So what do you understand by indeterminate growth? It means that if I were to talk about the plants, they keeps on growing. Okay, they keeps on growing. So it comes under that when there will be indefinite growth, we are calling it indeterminate time. Okay, when we are talking about a determinate growth, we are talking about that at some point. Okay, for example, in case of human beings, what happens we can say before the 25 years, what is happening? Your body keeps growing more and more, and after 25 there will be less growth. Okay, internally it is going to happen, but externally you cannot see such that growth. Okay, so we can say determinate growth is what, once it has been achieved, it has been done. Okay, examples can be human beings here in case of determinate growth, and in case of indeterminate growth there will be plants, right? So there are some classification how we have classified the growth. Okay, now another classification is internal growth as well as external growth. The name itself indicates, what is it? Internal means something is growing from inside. Okay, it means that the cells which are present inside your body, they keeps on growing more and more. They are keeps on dividing. Due to this, there will be an increase in number of cells, right? So this is what, this is the internal growth. And another one is the external growth. The growth can be external also. It means that when the growth takes place at the outermost part. Okay, so another name of this internal growth, it is also known as the intrinsic growth. Intrinsic means something which is happening from inside, as well as it is also known as interception. Okay, so during the examination you can get any name, so you have to understand that what are these things. These are the same, what you can say, internal growth, intrinsic growth or interception. Okay, likewise, if the growth will take place externally or from the outside of the body, it is known as external growth or the extrinsic or the accretion, right? Why I am talking about these two type of growth? What is the importance to be discussed here? Because we know that some growth takes place in case of non-living one also. Okay, and what is that growth? It is known as the external growth. Okay, so here what we can give the example, if I will give the example of mountains. Okay, in mountains what is happening? Growth is there. As I have said, growth is what? It can be increase in mass or it can be increase in number of cells. Both are the characteristics of growth. So what is happening here? If you will see these mountains in the Himalayan range, okay, due to the glaciers and all, what is happening? They keeps on always covered, okay, they keeps on covered with some snow. Okay, due to this, what is happening? Mountains are this much, but due to these glaciers or the snow, what is happening? Their mass is going to increase. Okay, and this mass, increase in mass, it is happening from the outer part. Okay, and this increase in number, what you are calling it? Accretion. Okay, which is happening from the outside, right? Likewise, if I will talk about the sand dunes, okay, or the sand mounds, what is happening? Due to the accumulation of the sand, their mass will get increased, right? So likewise, whenever we are talking about the increase in mass, so we can see in the non-living also. So we cannot say that growth is the defining property or growth is the exclusive property of the life. Okay, we can say that yes, growth is the characteristic of life, but it is not the defining property or it is not the exclusive property. So what should be our conclusion? That it is not a exclusive property, it is not a exclusive property of life, right? It is not exclusive property of life. Why? Because some of the living, non-living one also, they are increasing their mass, and due to this increase in mass, we know that this is the characteristics of growth. And whenever we are talking about the growth, it should be intrinsic. Okay, the growth should be done from the internal side also, right? And on the basis of that, we can say life is not that much defining property of the life, right? So growth is not the defining property. So this is the first characteristics and we have proved it. So in very short, I can say that growth as well as reproduction, okay? So these, we are not considering them as a life, okay? And out of these five, we are considering the last three characteristics, we are considering it as a defining property, okay? So first thing, we have proved that growth is not a defining property. Now comes to the another one, that is a reproduction. Okay, we are saying that if someone is growing, okay, if someone is producing their progeny, so what is happening? Reproduction is there, and marker, they don't have any capacity to give the another marker by themselves, right? So we can break it, okay, we can break it, but we cannot say that it can undergo the reproduction. That's why we are saying it is non-living. But exactly it is non-living, yes or no? So we will understand it here. So reproduction is what? If I will talk about the simple definition of reproduction, re means again and again, production means to produce. So it means that when there will be again and again production of this offspring from the parent, it is known as reproduction. Okay. And here there are different mode of reproduction. It can be asexual mode of reproduction and it can be sexual mode of reproduction. Okay, so in asexual mode of reproduction, as this A indicates, absence of sex, okay, or absence of the gamete. So in this asexual reproduction, there are no need of gametes, okay. Only one parent body is considered as the formation of another progeny. Okay, so we can say only one parent is able to give rise to the offspring or to the progenies, right? But in case of sexual reproduction, there is need of two types of gametes, right? So there must be a two types of gamete, that is male gamete as well as female gamete. Okay, so when there will be fusion of this male and female gamete, then only there will be production of zygote, and this zygote will lead to the formation of offspring. Okay, here if I will talk about the male and female, so you must know that how we can indicate this male and female. The representation we are using it here for the male, this one, okay, and for the representation for the female, it can be this one. Okay, so please make sure that you should know that if I am drawing this structure, it means that yes, it is indicating something related to the male part, and if I am drawing this one, it is indicating the female part. Okay, and during the sexual reproduction, what is happening? There will be fusion of male and female gamete, which ultimately what is happening? It will lead to the formation of zygote. Okay, so this is what? This is the sexual reproduction, and the later chapters we will study in the detail, right? So here in the asexual reproduction, again this asexual reproduction can take place by another different modes, that is number one, spore formation. Okay, during the spore formation, what is happening? They are forming the asexual spores, example in case of fungi. So in case of fungi, what is happening? We can see that, for example, penicillium, right? In case of penicillium, what is happening? That there will be formation of some spores, right? Likewise, when there will be release of these spores, they are giving so many another fungi, right? So we can say that spore formation is one of the method of asexual reproduction. Why? Because only one parent body is able to give rise to several individuals. Okay, so this is what? Spore formation. Likewise, there is another method of asexual reproduction, that is the budding method. Okay, and you can see this budding method in Hydra. In Hydra, what is happening? That, for example, these are the tentacles, okay, in this Hydra. So at the base of the parent body, there will be formation of one bud-like structure. Okay, when it will get mature, it will detach from the parent body, and now it is able to make a new Hydra. Okay, so this is what? This is the budding method of asexual reproduction, right? Now comes to the fragmentation. Fragmentation you can see in the spirovera also, okay, or we can say filamentous algae. So in this, what is happening? If you will see the structure like this, what is happening? That if any of the body part, or if any part of this algae, it will broken down, it is having capacity to form a new one, or the new individuals, right? So what is happening, that the body will divide into different fragments, and each fragment having the capacity to form a new individual. Okay, again there is involvement of only one parent, and it comes under the asexual reproduction. Okay, then comes to the regeneration. Re means again and again, generation means to generate. Okay, so there is one example, planarium. Planaria must have studied in grade 10th also. So if I will talk about the planaria here, okay, the structures of planaria, if the it comes under the platyhelminthes, right? So what is happening in this planaria, if the body of planaria will divide it or will cut it into different part, okay, so each part have the tendency to form a new planaria. So what you will call it, it is a regeneration. Okay, and what type of regeneration? It is a true regeneration. Why? Because each fragment, or we can say each split, will form a new planaria. Right here, so we can say that all these methods are asexual. Why? Because there is involvement of only one parent. There is no formation of gametes, which takes place in case of sexual reproduction. Okay, so this is the summary of the reproduction here. What is our objective? To study that whether this reproduction is the defining property or the exclusive property of life, yes or no. Okay, when we are talking about some exceptions are what? Mules. How we are getting mules? When there will be a combination, or when there will be fusion between horse and donkey. Okay, what we are getting? We are getting mules. How we are getting mules? When there will be fertilization between the horse and donkey. Okay, so what is happening? We are getting mules. Both are what? Both are the fertile one, but these mules are sterile. Okay, they are not having any tendency to undergo the reproduction. Okay, that's why they are what? They are the sterile. Likewise, you can see in daily life, some human couples are also there, okay, and they are infertile, and it means that they don't have capacity, or they don't have that much thing to give birth to the young ones, right? So in that case, what we are calling them? Infertility is there, and in this infertility, they are not having capacity to reproduce. Okay, so again, in the sterile worker bee, if I will talk about the worker bees, are what? During the bee, there are three types of bees. What are they? The first bee, queen. Okay, second one, worker bees, and the third one are the drones. And these drones, they are indicating male one. Okay, and these two, they are the female one. But if you will talk about the queen, it is having only capacity to reproduce. It will undergo the reproduction. But what about the worker bees? The role of worker bees is what? To give nursing to the progeny which is forming from the queen. Okay, so it means that queen, they are the fertile one, and these worker bees, they are the sterile one, right? So we can say these are some examples or the exception in which you are seeing that there is no reproduction. So now, can you say that they are living? Yes, they are living. It indicates that yes, reproduction is the characteristic of life, but it is not the defining property of life, or we can say it is not an exclusive property of life. Why? Because they are also living. Okay, they are also living, but they are not undergoing the reproduction. Okay, so reproduction, again, what we can conclude from here, that reproduction is what? It is not a defining property of life, right? So from here, what we have concluded, it is not a defining property of life, because these individuals, which are the exception, they can also live in this world, right? So we can say that it's not a defining property. Okay, now we will understand the third characteristic, that is the metabolism. In the metabolism, what do you understand? It means that it is the sum total of all the activities, all the chemical reaction which is taking place inside the body. Okay, so what type of reaction is it is going to happen? We know that in our living organisms, in our body, what is happening? The things is going to split and something is going to form. So it means that there will be two things. What are they? It can be, there may be construction, okay, or there will be destruction. What is construction? If you are forming, okay, if you are forming something from smaller one to a bigger thing, this is the constructive one. And what do you understand by destruction? If I am going to break this larger molecules into the simpler one, what it is denoting? It is denoting destruction. Okay, so this type of reaction should keeps on working inside the body. If it will not be there inside the body, what will happen? There will be no life. It means that there is no life, the individual is dead, right? So for any living organism, what should be the criteria? That these two chemical reaction keeps on working, okay? And these two type of reaction which is happening inside the body, they are known as the anabolism. What you are calling it? Anabolism. And another one is the catabolism. Okay, and simply we can say anabolism is a constructive unit, catabolism is a destructive unit. Okay, so if we are consuming or if you are taking carbohydrate proteins in our diet, what is happening? It is breaking down into the simpler one. So we can say what is happening, that there will be some catabolism, right? Or if I will talk about the photosynthesis, in photosynthesis what is happening? With the help of some inorganic materials, we are forming the complex one. For example, with the help of CO2, water, what you are getting? You are forming the C6H12O6. Okay, and this C6H12O6, it is what? It is a glucose, and this is the complex food, right? And why it is happening? Because the combination of inorganic, and it will form the larger part, right? So these type of reactions should work inside the organism of living one. If I will talk about the plants, in plants what is happening? There will be anabolism. In case of human beings or animals, what is happening? Catabolism. Example is respiration. That's why respiration and photosynthesis, they are reverse to each other. Okay, photosynthesis is what? Formation of glucose, okay? Respiration, breakdown of glucose, okay? It is happening, that breakdown of glucose, and due to this breakdown, what is happening? We are getting energy, okay? So here, one more question arises, that what is the difference between anabolism and catabolism? So how many points you can write it here? Anabolism is a constructive unit, catabolism is a destructive unit. Examples, photosynthesis in case of plants, respiration in case of animals here, or the human beings, as well as due to the anabolism, what is happening? There will be some energy, but here in catabolism, when there will be breakdown of food, it will release some energy. Okay, so it is forming the energy and it is releasing the energy. Okay, so these are the differences here. Now question arises, that what about the defining property? Whether this metabolism is a defining property? Yes. Okay, answer is yes. Why? Because you can see this anabolism, catabolism only in case of living organism. You cannot see all these things happening inside the non-living organisms. Okay, so yes, metabolic activity is a defining property of the living organism. Again, there is one point in NCERT, in vitro and in vivo. Okay, what is it? In vitro and in vivo. What do you understand by this thing? In vitro means something which is happening inside the vessel. Vitro means what? Vessel. And another one is the vivo. It means that whenever we are talking about the in vitro, it means that we are talking about the lab conditions, right? In vivo, in which is happening in the natural, okay, in nature itself. For example, inside your body, whatever it is happening, it comes into the in vivo. And if you are talking about the lab condition, for example, we are mixing A plus B and we are getting C. We are taking the reactant and we are getting the product. Okay, so what is happening? Something is forming here due to the addition. Okay, and due to this, what is happening? That we are getting C here. So this is what? This is the in vitro condition. So whenever the reaction will take place inside this test tube, so we can say, for example, this is a, whatever the things which you have dissolved here. So this vessel, it is indicating non-living, but the reaction which is happening inside this test tube, it is the living one. Okay, so make sure that if question will be there, what is the example? Yes, test tube is non-living, but the reaction is a living one. So by this also we can say that yes, metabolism is what? It is the defining property, or it is the exclusive property of only and only the living organism. You cannot see it in any of the non-living one. Okay,
Now comes to the another characteristic, that is a cellular organization. What do you understand by cellular organization? It means that whatever the body, whether it is a unicellular or the multicellular, okay? Unicellular means that body is made up of only one cell, okay? If body is made up of one cell here, we are calling it unicellular or more cell, okay? More cell, it is multicellular. So in both the condition, what is happening? It is made up of some organization, okay? And if you will see example of one unicellular, what is it? Amoeba, okay? So in amoeba also, there will be metabolism. As well as, if you will see the structure, there is some nucleus as well as cytoplasm. Okay, this one is the nucleus and this one is the cytoplasm. And what is the protoplasm then? When we are, and inside the nucleus, what is present? Nucleoplasm, right? So whenever we are combinedly talking about this cytoplasm and the nucleoplasm, what it is forming? It is forming the protoplasm. Okay, and this protoplasm is very, very important because this is the living matter of any cell. Okay, if I will talk about the unicellular one, this is the structure. If I will talk about the multicellular, if I will talk about the plant cell, animal cells, all they are what? They are multicellular. So what you can see, again, cell is present like this only. Nucleus is there, inside the nucleus, fluid is there, nucleoplasm, and inside the cell, cytoplasm, and combinedly both they are working. Okay, along with this, they are having some cell organelles, for example, mitochondria, then endoplasmic reticulum, right, Golgi bodies. So all these cell organelles, they are present in the cell. So what they are doing, they are coordinating with each other. Okay, due to this coordination, what is happening? There will be activities at the cellular level. Okay, but you cannot see these things happening inside the non-living one. Okay, because this marker is not made up of any cell, right? So how these activities will take place? So for any of the living organisms, there is a cell, whether it is unicellular or the multicellular, and they are helping them to perform different types of activities at the cellular level. Okay, and due to this, what is happening? So many life processes takes place inside our body, and that's why you must have done about the life process in grade 10, that is what? Nutrition, respiration, circulation, excretion. What are these things? These are the life process. And what are the life process? Those processes which are very vital for the life, which is very, very important for the life. These are known as the life process, and all the life processes happening at the cellular level. Okay, so we can say that yes, cellular organization, it is also a defining property of life, right? Then comes to the consciousness. What do you understand by consciousness? It means that if someone is going to prick needle in your hand, what is going to happen? Your receptors, okay, you are responding to that external stimuli. That time the needle will become the stimuli, and the hand in your hands, receptors are present and they are responding to that particular stimuli. So we can say consciousness is what? Whenever there will be respond to the particular stimuli, it is known as the consciousness. Okay, so here we have written ability to sense their environment. If in my environment, if what is happening, if temperature will be high, what will happen? I will feel hot. Okay, if temperature will be low, I will feel cold. So what is my body doing? It is responding. So skin is one of the receptor, right? So likewise, whenever we are sensing, in case of plant also, if I will talk about the plants, they are also responding. How they are responding? Have you seen the plant touch me not? As you are touching it, what is happening? There will be some changes in their leaves. So they are also responding. Likewise, sunflower. Okay, it is orienting towards the sun. So what is happening? It is also acting, or it is also responding to its stimuli. Likewise, photoperiodism. Okay, whenever light is there, it is moving towards it. It is what? Towards the photoperiodism. So we can say so many external factors are there, like light, water, temperature. And due to this, what is happening? There will be some change in the body of the living organism. Okay, but this marker cannot respond. Okay, so that's why we are saying it is not having ability to for the consciousness, right? So we can say that the the stimuli can be physical, chemical or biological. Okay, whatever it is, their body is going to respond against it. Right? So we have done that consciousness, yes, it is the defining property of life. Okay, but there is one more term, self-consciousness. Okay, what do you understand by self-consciousness? It means that if I'm standing here, at the same time I'll be able to see that what is happening around me. Okay, so our body is very much advanced as compared to the plants, or we can say in a comparison to the lower organism. So what is happening here, that we are having the tendency of self-consciousness, right? Likewise, if I say that the person which is in the coma, what is happening, that his body is not being able to move here and there, but the medicines the doctors they are providing to him, what is happening, their body is going to respond on that medicine. So we can say that self-consciousness is only and only defining property of human life. Okay, if there can be two questions, what can be the two questions, that yes, consciousness is the defining property, yes, but self-consciousness, it is not the defining property of life. Okay, it is only and only defining property of human life. Okay, so there is difference between these two. Okay, now comes to the body organization. Okay, if I'm talking about the living organism, so it means that body is made up of some components. The components can be physical as well as the biological. Okay, so all these components, they are combining with each other and it is performing some activity in the living organism. So these are what, there are some components as well as subcomponents which are cooperating with each other, and due to this, what is happening, there will be change in the body. So all these living organisms, they are organized. An example you must have done, that what is happening, cell, there will be accumulation of cell, it is forming tissue, and due to this formation of organ, then organ system, then there will be organism. Okay, so life is forming from where? From very small thing, that is cell. Cell is the basic unit of life, from where the life has been originated. Okay, so what is happening, everything happening in the sequence. Okay, and they are cooperating with each other. So all these, they are considering what, it is known as what, biological or the living hierarchy. Okay, but if I will see about the cell, how it is made up of. Okay, it is made up of very small things, like if you will talk about the electron, proton, neutron. You all know about this thing, electron, proton and neutron. What they are forming? They are forming what? They are forming some atoms. Okay, and these atoms will form some compounds, and again this will form the cell. Okay, so after these we are considering as a physical or the non-living hierarchy. Right, so whenever we are talking about this body organization, it is made up of both physical as well as biological hierarchy, and here everything goes on sequence. Okay, if you will see it here, these are very 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 small. Okay, so if you are moving from here to here, what is happening, that the complexion will getting increased. Okay, if you move from here to this side, what is happening, the complexion is going to decrease. Right, so as we are moving to the higher organism, the complication will be more, by because the body organization will be advanced one. Okay, so again, this body organization is the defining property of the life. So we have considered here so many characteristics of life, and out of them, reproduction as well as the growth, it will not be the defining property of life, and rest of the things like metabolism, cellular organization, consciousness, body organization, it comes under the defining property of life. Okay, and finally we can conclude that how life it is self-replicating. It means that it can form its another part by itself, or it is self-evolving or the self-regulating. Okay, so these things happening in the life of any individual which is alive. Okay, so here we have completed the first topic. So that's all for today. Thank you.